Next month, Australians will be given the opportunity to participate in a non-compulsory, non-legally binding postal plebiscite regarding the legalisation of same-sex marriage. But the decision to appoint the Australian Bureau of Statistics to conduct the plebiscite has raised questions over its legitimacy. While the ballot papers remain sealed, the burning question is a postal plebiscite run by the Australian Bureau of Statistics constitutional? Let's find out.
So I would expect it to be held this calendar year, but it will be held as soon as practical, as obviously legislation has got to pass through the Parliament.
Legislation introduced into the Senate by the Turnbull government to enact a same-sex marriage plebiscite was first defeated in November 2016 and again in August 2017. Determined to fulfil one of its key campaign promises, the federal government has decided to scrap a compulsory vote which requires legislation to pass through the Senate and instead have opted to conduct a postal plebiscite, which does not. The government has appointed the Australian Bureau of Statistics to conduct the postal plebiscite because the Australian Electoral Commission's jurisdiction precludes its involvement in non-compulsory votes. To find out if the Australian Bureau of Statistics and the government are acting within their authority, I spoke with constitutional law expert Adrienne Stone at Melbourne University Law School.
There has never been anything of precisely this nature before, and in particular I've never seen anything that is described as a vote or a plebiscite or performs this role being conducted by the Australian Bureau of Statistics.
Regardless of its constitutional legitimacy, Adrienne believes that by sidestepping the Senate for legislative approval, the plebiscite is less likely to change the law.
It's inefficient, yes, it's totally ineffective, and it's costly, right? And more to the point, what concerns me about it is that its very peculiar features are going to undermine its political legitimacy. The only value it could possibly have would be to give some kind of political legitimacy to the result. But when you use a process that is as compromised and as exceptional as this, it is at serious risk, even if there is a yes vote, that the political legitimacy of that result is just undermined by the many odd and inadequate features of the process.
As of the airing of this episode, equal marriage advocates are challenging the plebiscite in the High Court, where they hope to prove that the Australian Bureau of Statistics is acting outside of its constitutional jurisdiction, and that the government is not justified in spending $122 million taxpayer dollars on a vote without Senate approval. According to Adrienne, the answer lies within the fine print of the Bureau's enacting legislation.
So the government's argument is this is just the ABS carrying out its functions and we're able to spend for that purpose. But if the argument succeeds to say this isn't something that the ABS is entitled to do, then the question will come up, what could be the authority under which the Commonwealth spends that money? And it will be difficult for the Commonwealth to answer it unless it can show that the ABS has authority in the ABS's enacting enabling legislation.
After months of legislative gridlock in the Senate, the Turnbull governments have ultimately found an ad hoc solution to an otherwise doomed policy promise. And according to Adrienne, by trying to satisfy Australians and deliver a plebiscite by any means necessary, they've seemingly sacrificed the intended impact of a compulsory and legislatively ratified plebiscite.
I think it's probably more likely to be, I think it increased the chances of it being legally valid by giving it to the ABS, but undermined the chances of it being politically legitimate.
Thank you for watching The Burning Question. If you want to stay up to date with our latest episodes and stories, feel free to like us on Twitter and Facebook. Thanks for watching.